Welcome to this special episode. It is Saturday morning. Thank you for joining me today. Just got two topics because also today will be my Democrat debate recap, so it'll kind of all be right there. And that'll be a little extra. That'll be probably 8 or 9 minutes as well. This one hopefully will go 6 or 7, depending on how much I start rambling. Okay. So we start off, we'll go with the Pac-12, and we'll talk about the championship and who I think is going to be the player of the year in the conference. First of all, we have the championship between Washington and Utah. I have Washington winning the North. I think it's going to be a great division. By far, obviously, the better of the Pac-12 divisions. I have them beating Oregon, but I think it'll be close between those two teams. I really do. Could go either way. But I think Washington gets it, and I think that Washington beats Utah for the second straight year in the Pac-12 championship. Chris Peterson and Kyle Whittingham are two of my favorite coaches, but I like this Washington team. Again, I think Jacob Eason will win the starting job. I think he'll be very good, as he was at Georgia. And I like their makeup. I like the way Chris Peterson's recruited. I like the culture he's built in Seattle. And I think that Washington wins the Pac-12 championship for the second straight year, and a 3 out of 4, I believe. Pretty incredible what he's doing there. And that 1 year, I think it was USC who went to the Rose Bowl. And then for player of the year, I'd love to say it's Jacob Eason, but it's hard for me to say because he hasn't actually won the job yet, which is kind of scary in its own right. But there are a number of guys that could win it, but doesn't it just feel like Justin Herbert's going to win it, whether he's that great or not, just because of the hype around him, the fact that people think he's going to be the top pick, the fact that he had a lot of hype at the end of last year, although he was pretty bad down the stretch. Kind of mid-season was his peak hype, but he's certainly probably a top 10, top 15, maybe Heisman candidate coming into the year. Widely considered the best quarterback in the Pac-12, no doubt about that. And I think that Justin Herbert probably will win the Player of the Year award, even if he's not necessarily the best player. I could see it being a situation like that, where even you look at the SEC, I think there are plenty of guys that are going to have a good year throwing the football. But I imagine, almost regardless of what happens, Tua is probably going to win SEC Player of the Year, because that's just kind of the way it goes. That's kind of the way the voters work. And, you just learn to accept that. So I think Justin Herbert wins Player of the Year. And, again, I think he's a good quarterback. I think he's overrated, though. But certainly, if he improved a lot this offseason, then I'm excited to watch the Oregon Ducks and Justin Herbert play. That's all I got on the Pac-12. Should be a fun year out there. I'm hoping teams start to kind of improve, and we see some improvement from Chip Kelly, Kevin Sumlin, Herm Edwards in year two, and those teams really start to kind of build quality programs, and the Pac-12 can return to glory, hopefully, because it's been trash lately. All right, and we go to the top 5 running backs for this year's fantasy football, and at number 5 I have David Johnson of the Cardinals. I think Cliff Kingsbury is going to be able to find a way to get him the ball all over the field. I think he's going to catch a ton of passes. I know he's obviously going to be a 3-down back for them. They're going to have Kyler Murray, so they're going to be able to do a lot of different dynamic things, and especially when the defense has to account for the quarterback. Running backs can go wild and offenses like that because, again, it's just one fewer guys that are accounting for the running back. Now, the issue with Johnson, obviously, is if Kyler comes out and he can't throw the ball down the field, he can't complete passes, will that allow teams to just stack the box? A corollary to that is, again, Kyler can run the ball. So no matter what, you have to have a guy accounting for Kyler, and I just think it sets up David Johnson well. I think he catches 50, 60 passes, and I think 2,000 scrimmage yards is not unheard of this year for David Johnson. Number 4, I have Christian McCaffrey. I'd like to put him higher, but there's so many elite backs right now. You know he's going to catch passes. You know he's going to get the ball. Especially, I imagine they're going to try to run Cam less, which means probably more carries for McCaffrey. So I like that as well with Cam coming back from the injury. I do worry about his durability. He's a small guy, got a ton of carries last year, got just beat up. I think he played all 16 games, which is pretty crazy. But he's a great back. I do worry about his durability, but if he's sitting there at number four and I'm there, I'm going to take him. There's no doubt about it. Number three, I have Alvin Kamara of the Saints. Look, when you're playing with Drew Brees, everybody's valuable. We've seen this year after year after year after year. You have Michael Thomas on the outside. Now you have Jared Cook. So many weapons. Mark Ingram's gone. So Kamara, you remember how he was in the first six games last year before Ingram came back? He was unbelievable. His numbers were still good after that, but without Ingram, he was absolutely incredible. And I expect him to have that production over a full season. Number two, I have Ezekiel Elliott. Obviously, if he plays, I mean, he's holding out right now. We'll see what happens with him and his contract situation moving forward with the Cowboys. But, I mean, he's led the league in rushing two out of the 3 years, and the one he didn't was because he had a six-game suspension. So, you know, you can't not rank him highly, especially when he's a pass catcher and a three-down back, and he can block in the passing game so they don't have to take him out. He's a no-brainer, number two, which leaves number one, obviously, Saquon Barkley. It's close between he and Zeke, for sure, and Kamara, even. I think any of those guys could be at one, and I wouldn't blink an eye. But Saquon is just so dynamic in the open field. He could play receiver if he wanted to. That's how good of a route runner and pass catcher he is. He's just absolutely incredible, and the moves he makes in the open field, he's got some of the best vision I've ever seen. He's very durable, very stout, and he's in an offense that's certainly going to try to feed him the ball. The issue, obviously, is can Eli deliver the ball downfield to Evan Ingram and Sterling Shepard and guys like that? Will he be able to do that and free up Saquon? I think he'll do just enough, and Saquon's going to have a big year. But again, if you take Kamara or Zeke at one, I don't think you're crazy. That's all I've got for today. Check back in a couple hours for my Democrat debate recap. I will have that up today. Thank you for watching. Make sure to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell so you know when we are live every morning at 6 a.m. And I will see y'all in a couple hours.